Hey y'all, Karen from the future here with a small announcement. I have started streaming on Twitch. If you are interested in learning a little bit more deep dive stuff about some of my roleplay opinions, or if you have questions for me, please join me on twitch.tv/itskarenterry. Every Saturday Eastern time from noon to 2.
You think it's so cool. And who the hell wouldn't love reading 10,000 words of lore about your world? The answer is everyone. Nobody wants to read 10,000 words of lore.
Spare Room with Karen Terry.
Hey y'all, and welcome to Spare Room. I'm Karen Terry, and today we're going to talk about 5 tips for writing your lore book. This is part 2 of a 2-part video. In the first part, we talked about what a lore book is, what a lore book isn't, and all of the different things that go into a lore book. I'm going to link that video up in the card. I do recommend you guys watch that before you continue with this particular video, because in this video, I am assuming that you already saw it, so you have all the context for what I'm talking about. All right, with that being said, let's dive into the tips. Tip number 1, be organized. There are lots of different ways you can manage your lore book. I am running my current roleplay in Discord, so the way that I'm managing it is I have a category called Important, and all of the different channels for the different pieces of the lore book are listed under that category. You might have your lore book as a wiki, or as a website, or as a series of Google Docs, or maybe it's a section on a forum. Exactly where you put your lore book is going to depend a lot on the platform that you're running your roleplay on and the norms that exist there, and also how lore heavy or lore light your roleplay is. No matter where you put your lore book, however, it must be organized. It's up to you to guide the reader through your lore book in a way where each section builds on the previous section. This is why in my structure video, what I said is that the plot summary goes very first, and then the FAQ goes towards the end. This is why, for example, the cast section goes after the species and location section. Think about it, in a supernatural roleplay where everyone is a different species, reading the cast bios before you go through and read about how the different species are set up, the bios aren't going to make any sense. So, you must take a step back from the lore you've written and think about it as somebody that's coming to your lore that knows nothing about the world you've created. Now, if you're not a good proofreader, this is likely going to be difficult for you, but don't fret. What I would recommend is to ask your friends to go through your lore book and help you understand if it makes sense or not. Also, I run a roleplay help Discord server, linked down in the description. If you need a third-party perspective on your lore book, feel free to pop into there and ask whatever questions you have, ask for people to read through certain sections, things like that. We'll give you real-time feedback. Alright, so tip number 2, stick to the need-to-know information, not the nice-to-know information. You love your world. You think it's so cool. And who the hell wouldn't love reading 10,000 words of lore about your world? The answer is everyone. Nobody wants to read 10,000 words of lore. So you must go through your lore with a fine-tooth comb and remove everything that is not need to know. A lore book is what players read before they begin engaging in your roleplay. So if a piece of information is not needed to start engaging in your roleplay, it shouldn't be in the lore book. Remember in my World Building 101 video where we talked about how once you launch your roleplay, the world doesn't belong to you anymore? That means you must have wiggle room for players to put their own spin on things in the world, and if your lore book describes every little detail about your lore, that means players can't do that. So, cut the fluff and get to the stuff. Your lore book is need-to-know information only. Alright, tip number 3, refer back to your axioms. So, how do you know what's actually need-to-know information? For this, refer back to those axioms. We talked about building these axioms for your world in my World Building 101 video. It was probably linked up in the card earlier, so make sure you go watch that if you have not. But when you're looking through your lore book and trying to decide what is need-to-know information, what is actually fluff versus stuff, you can refer back to those axioms to try to decide if something is need-to-know. Does a particular piece of information support one of your axioms? Or is it in there because you thought it was cool? Is this something that will help players understand your world? Is this something that all players need to be imagining in the same way? Is this something that doesn't really matter to the roleplay if players get it wrong? Your axioms will help you determine this. If a piece of information does not benefit the ease of roleplay and doesn't support one of your axioms, it's fluff. Cut it. All right, tip number 4. We touched on this a little bit at the end of tip 1 and we're circling back. Have your veteran players and moderators help you. Proofreading your own stuff is hard. Making decisions about what to cut versus what to keep versus what needs additions is hard. So I'm going to share with you my method of how I do this in my roleplays. So I'll write a first draft that usually includes the plot summary and a few other things that I think are important to the roleplay. In my current roleplay, Atlantis, for example, I had a plot summary and I had all of the different species descriptions that I wanted in there. So I first write a first draft, and that typically includes the plot summary and a few other elements that I think are important to the roleplay. In my current roleplay, Atlantis, for example, what I had first was the plot summary, some information about the families, and also the different species that I wanted to include since it was a supernatural roleplay. Then I showed this to my mod team one by one. I didn't pull all three of them in. I showed it to the first one, collected feedback, made additions and edits, showed it to the second one, collected feedback, made additions and edits, then I pulled in the third one and showed it to everybody. This helps me make sure that the feedback I'm getting is really pure and good and we're avoiding groupthink because we've been working together for so long that can easily happen to us. At that stage, we had to start writing all of the things that needed to still be written for others to understand the roleplay. For example, I knew I wanted some kind of plant-based species, but I hadn't actually written one yet, so one of the mods took on writing that species, and then we collectively decided what species we were going to cut to make room for the plant-based species. We also wrote a lot of the stuff for the About Atlantis section, just as an example, that basically got fleshed out when the mod team all came together. And essentially what we did is we got the lore book to a place where all of us liked it and we thought it communicated everything properly. But I'm not dumb, and like I said before, me and my mods have been working together for years, so that means it's easier for us to communicate with each other than with others, so that means I know even though there's 4 of us, we still miss stuff. So the next step is to pull in our veteran players. So what we did is we closed down the previous roleplay that we were running, and we pulled our veteran players that were in that roleplay into a planning session for this roleplay, and they went through that same process that me and my mods all went through together again. They proofread sections of the roleplay, they provided feedback on things that were confusing, they went through and found awkward sentences, all those sorts of things. And this was the first time that they were seeing the roleplay, so they were able to look at the lore book with fresh eyes and think about things that the mods and I hadn't considered. So once you get to this step with the veteran players, your role as the admin is to collect that feedback and figure out how to implement it. Some of your veteran players will be better than others at providing feedback. Some will be able to describe both the problem and how to fix it. Some will be able to describe the problem just fine, but their proposed fix will not be correct. And some won't really be able to describe either, they'll just be able to point out how they felt. Your job is to figure out how to address what's at the core of each piece of feedback. You don't have to implement everything, but you do need to consider everything. This process will give you the best lore book at the end of the day, and when you release to others and actually open up your roleplay, you'll have something that you can really be proud of. All right, last tip, number 5. Your lore book is a living document. You may think after you've gone through it, after your mods have gone through it, after your veteran players have gone through it, that it's perfect. But you're wrong. There's still confusing things. There's still missing information. There's still things that could be organized better. But that's okay, because this is a living document. Also, you watched my structure video that I did a couple weeks ago, and so you have an FAQ implemented in your lore book. Don't be scared to keep editing and adding to your lore book, especially in the first 2 months, and especially to the FAQ section. Players will always come up with things that you never thought about, be it inconsistencies in the lore book that you didn't catch, or maybe questions that you didn't consider because you weren't making that type of character or none of your veteran players or mods were. Or maybe it's something that seemed like it made sense, but then once the roleplay got going and you started playing, you found out, actually, that makes no sense. Don't be scared to make changes. Lorebooks are not chiseled into stone. They can always be edited, added to, or have things cut from them later. It's totally fine. And it's normal to do this, especially during the beginning stages of a new roleplay. So those are five of my top lorebook writing tips. So to recap, first, be organized. Second, stick to the need-to-know information. Third, refer to your axioms. Four, have your mods and veteran players help you. And five, remember, your lorebook is a living document. So do you guys do this kind of stuff already? If not, now that you've watched this video, are you thinking of implementing it into your next roleplay? Let me know down below. I would love to see all of you guys' lorebooks and how they're set up and what you've taken away and made changes to in them based on the information in this video and also in the other one. And of course, as always, don't forget to make it a great day.